Chapter 3, that is Colonial Agrarian Policies. Here we are going to learn about major land revenue settlements. The first reform introduced by the company came in the form of the Ijardari system. Then came the permanent settlement, then Rotwari and Mahalwari system. Ijardari system was introduced by Warren Hastings. Right for revenue collection was given to the highest bidder for 5 years. This system came to be called Ijardari or revenue farming. Those who had given this right were called Ijardars. Permanent settlement. The permanent settlement was introduced by Lord Cornwallis. According to this system, land owner or zamindars acquired hereditary rights over land. Farmers were reduced to status of tenants and they lost the right to use pasture, forest lands, irrigation canals, fishing ponds. Zamindars had to pay fixed amount of land revenue every year to the company, even under adverse condition. Whatever remained with zamindars was their profit. Advantages to company. Zamindar acted as a natural ally in the event of any rebellion by the peasants. Income of EEIC from land revenue was secure, regular and stable. Effects on peasants. Actual cultivators were left at mercy of zamindars. The peasants had to pay revenue even if their crops failed. In case of non-repayment of loans, their land was mortgaged. Peasants were evicted from the land they cultivated for generations. Now, Mahalwari settlement. It was introduced by Holt Mackenzie. Unit of revenue settlement was village or Mahal, and revenue demand was made collectively on village. Lambardar, the village headman, collected the revenue and handed it over to the government. The rate of revenue was roughly half of the total agricultural produce. Condition of peasants remained pitiable. Rotwari settlement. It was introduced by Thomas Munro. It was further extended to the Bombay Presidency and Assam. In South India, there were no traditional zamindars and the land actually belonged to the cultivators, that is Rhodes. Both Munro and Reed felt that the land settlements must be made directly with the Rhodes. Thus, the system came to be known as the Rotwari settlement. The land revenue was not collected by the zamindar or lambardar but was taken from the roads or cultivators directly. They deposited it in the government treasury. Next is commercialization of agriculture. Commercialization of agriculture means that peasants grow more than what he and his family can consume and sell the rest in the market. All the classes of people including zamindars, the lambardar, rot had to make provision of cash. They sold the part of their produce in the market so as to be able to pay cash revenue to treasury. Peasants were encouraged to cultivate high value crops which were not needed locally and were only meant for export. Impact of commercialization of agriculture. Commercial crops were often cultivated at the cost of food crops. This led to impoverishment of the peasantry. Since these crops were sold in international market, their demands fluctuated widely. In the year of good harvest, it benefited the peasants. But in case of poor harvest, the peasants suffered badly. Much of the land was set aside for non-fruit crops The peasants did not have enough to eat. Major commercial crops. In the first phase of colonial rule, opium and indigo were grown. From mid-19th century, the demand of few commercial crops increased, like jute, cotton and rubber. In the 19th century, jute became an important raw material as it was in great demand in European factories. Cultivation of opium. Opium was cultivated in Western India and exported to China in exchange for Chinese tea. The British brought tea from China and had to pay for it in silver because the Chinese did not want Western goods. Cultivation of indigo. It was used by cloth manufacturers to dye clothes. Indian indigo was in great demand in British and other European countries due to increase in cotton production after the Industrial Revolution. Indigo cultivation. There were two main systems of indigo cultivation, niche and roti cultivation. Niche system. Under this system, planters produced indigo on land that they directly controlled. Either they bought the land or rented it. Hired laborers were appointed to produce the indigo. The roti system. Since the planters failed with the niche system, they introduced the roti system, in which a contract was signed between the roads and the planters. The rotis were given the loans and forced to grow only indigo on at least 25% of area under holdings. Later, the peasants were informed that loans could be repaid only by supplying indigo to planters at fixed low rates. Indigo Revolt or the Blue Rebellion. In 1859, the Rohs in Bengal refused to grow indigo and did not pay rents to planters. They attacked indigo factories and socially boycotted peasants who continued the work. Women revolted, the Gumasthas who collected rent were beaten up, and the Rohs refused to make advances to sow indigo. The revolt started from Gobindpur in the Nadia districts of Bengal, led by Digambar and Bisambar Vishwas. It soon spread to all districts of Bengal. In Bengal, the British government was forced to appoint the Indigo Commission to review the corrupt practice relating to this system. Gradually, it moved to Bihar.